poverty 2018. It shouldn't be hearing poverty 2018, it should be all women and all people who menstruate should have access to safe social protection. At this one moment in time, there's 800 million women menstruating in the world. Just give you that information. A lot of women, and a lot of them don't have access. So they're using things like toilet paper, they're using socks. In Kenya and Africa, they're using dung, ash, bits of mattresses, bits of rag, corn husks, leaves, anything they can get their hands on. And that's not a nice thing to do. And they're always worried about they're going to leak. There's a lot of stigma and taboo about it. So my journey started about 5 years ago when I started visiting Kenya with a friend of mine, doing a project around mothers and babies. After a couple of years and two or three trips there, I'm not a medical person, so I thought, do you know what, I want to find something that I can do and I can make a change. So I found and looked around and I realised that 60% of girls and women in Kenya don't have access to safe sexual protection, which means they're missing 5 days of school, or up to 5 days of school, every month. They suffer all sorts of issues, and also a lot of the girls, well, around about 10% of the girls in a piece of research that I read, actually sleep with boys to get money to buy sanitary towels, because the poverty is that much. And it's not just Kenya, it's obviously the most developing countries and also third world countries as well. So what I decided to do is do something about it. I'm just a normal mum, you know, thought I wanted to do something. So what I did is I got my friends together in a church hall. So bring your sewing machines, let's make some sanitary towels. Because I knew disposables, it's a one-use thing, you know, it's not sustainable. So I looked around at different projects to see if I can do something more sustainable. So we looked at washable, reusable sanitary products. And we had a great afternoon that day making really bad sanitary products. So what we did then is I looked around at different models of works. I'd looked into this. And what happened was there was a charity called Days for Girls who'd been around about 8 years, started in America, and they've been perfecting washable, reusable sanitary products that last up to 3 years, which I thought was absolutely fantastic. And they also perfected education as well for the girls, and also for the boys. So I thought this is the way to go, really. It's, you know, and started trying to find funding, and it just so happened that a lady who I used to work with saw that first workshop of mine in the church hall and said, apply for some funding, it's a really good project. So I managed to get £5,000 worth of funding and toddled off to Kenya to try and set up a project, which I duly did for a while. And then what happened is it got bigger. It got more, there was lots and lots of girls. The first thing I did is I went to an elder in a village in Kenya and I said, we want to do a project for your girls. And we want to make them stay in education. We want to give them these sanitary products. And he said, oh, that's fantastic, you've come from above. I'll take you around to all the schools. And he took us around to, there was going to be 7 schools in the area, but after 4 I said, you know what, we can't do anymore, because we only have a certain amount of money to do that. So we ended up making sanitary products, going back to the schools, and I mean, it was amazing. The difference in the girls was just amazing. And then I met this lady called Linda, who had been in Kenya. She had been a UK charity running in Kenya for 17 years. And she'd been building schools, and she said, you know what, I didn't realise. She said, I always wondered why girls when they get from primary school to high school, their marks went down. And she said, now I know why. So we got together, and for a year or so, we did a lot of fundraising. So last year, we set up 2 workshops in Kenya to make these, so it brings women out of poverty here. This is Gladys and her worker here, so it's one of the workshops. We managed to produce 4,000 sanitary products and educate around about, I don't know, 4,000 to 6,000 girls and boys. Because what we thought in Kenya, we'll educate the girls and the boys together to stop the stigma and taboo. They'll know about each other, it's the norm, and they won't be embarrassed by it. So that's what we did. This is me here with some of the girls. This is one of the... and they're so pleased, the girls. The feedback we've had from the teachers is they've got 100% attendance. Their marks have gone up. They're happy in themselves. They're comfortable. Their self-esteem has increased no end. They're not shuffling around because they've got a piece of rag between their legs. And also as well, what comes with using unsanitary products is they get infections. So a lot of girls get infections as well. And that's what we did here. And these are the packs that we use. So these are washable reusables that we use. They come in two separate pieces, so they can change these here like this during the day. They have a bag with them as well. And there's like a waterproof liner in here. So we can just change these during the day. And it's a really, really good idea. And we also give them two pairs of knickers as well, because a lot of the girls in Kenya don't even have knickers, they don't even have pants. They use their mothers, unfortunately. So that was my little project in Kenya. Then last year, around about March last year, something happened. And a colleague of mine gave me a call and said, Tina, I've got a few girls here in this swing school, and I've discovered that they can't afford sanitary products. And I went, oh, okay then, that's really bad. Me working in sort of tackling health inequalities as my job, sort of then thought about it and thought, actually, you know, increase access to food banks. Again, it's like Kenya, if you can't afford food, for sanitary protection, so it's the same here. Families are going to food banks to get food because they can't afford, they've got the last 20 pence, and it was just like, actually, what do we need to do about this? So I rang up a few companies and said, you know, I want some sanitary towels. And then a friend of mine who had contact in the BBC got in touch with her, and they said, oh, and then next minute the phone started ringing and the BBC were on the line and said we want to do an interview. It was International Women's Day, 18th of March last year, and I went on it was Radio Leeds, then Look North, and it just went absolutely mad from there. I managed to get from a charity 18 pallet loads of sanitary protection from sanitary towels from a charity at North. I'm like, how am I going to get those to Leeds? So I rang up in Stobart and said, excuse me, I know you're like a logistics company, but could you deliver me these sanitary towels and I'll try and get you some publicity? And they went, yeah, that's fine. We have a charity here in Leeds called Fair Share, and they deliver to schools for their breakfast clubs. They deliver to refugees, and they also deliver everywhere to food banks and things like that. So that was my sort of inroad to actually getting these out, not just to the girls that need them, but to all girls. Because we thought, actually, you know, that there is a problem in the UK. And it's not just about people who are on benefits, it's the working poor, zero contract hours, the changing benefits. You know, if you're down to your last 50 pence, what do? You feed your children with a loaf of bread and toast? Or do you buy sanitary protection? So what I've heard is you buy a loaf of bread and you feed your children and you use one of the slices of bread as a sanitary towel. That's what I've heard anyway. So it's not very nice. So these were all, so from like radio, I went to, I was on then Woman's Hour, and then Jeremy Vine, and then 145 million people from the BBC World Service heard me as well, which was a bit interesting. So these were all just the things that happened. And then what happened is I decided, it's like actually lots of other, I found that there's lots of other people in the UK who were doing the same thing as me. So I got together with a big charity called Plan International and said, I'd like to do a summit, get everybody together, let's talk about this, we need to make a change. You know, without just dealing all these sanitary products without actually knowing what's going on. So what I did is the Plan International and an advisory group, we got summit together last October in Leeds, and we talked about what could we do, what is the solution, not just in the UK but worldwide. And it's a difficult one, really. I mean, since all the news broke last year, every political party apart from one has adopted a menstruation manifesto, which is absolutely brilliant. Labour has said we'll give you £10 million if you come into power. I think the government in Wales, they said they'll pledge some money as well. Plan International have just got £1 million to do a project about like the sea cards and condom card, where under 25s can get free condoms and education. So the pea card will be almost the same, so it's a trial, so where they'll get sanitary towels but education with them. Because what we found is girls weren't getting the education. So Plan International did a quite big survey with about 1,000, 2,000 girls, and what happened was they found that girls couldn't afford them, they didn't have the education, they were using inferior products, lots of things like that. And then in December, what happened here is I went to a protest with a young girl called Amika George. Amika heard me on Woman's Hour and thought it was absolutely terrible that girls in this day and age in the UK, which is one of the richest countries in the world, couldn't afford sanitary towels. So she is campaigning to give all girls on free school meals sanitary towels, which is really good. But it needs to be a universal offer. We found that girls don't even realise that they're having a period. 46% of girls are not ready. So it's not ready to, and prepared for when they have their period, which is not good. So this was the summit that we went to here. I mean, in the meantime, in Leeds, what I did is we set up donation stations in supermarkets and things like that so we could get more products out to more people. Once people knew about it, I was getting approached from all over the country and all over the world. In South Korea, the girls use the insoles of their shoes as sanitary products, sanitary towels, which is ridiculous, in straw and things like that. So Plan International did some research, because obviously they had a big group of women and girls. And these are the actual, some of the statistics. So if you want to read them, it's not good. It's not, for a developed country like the UK, this isn't good. I mean, what we want to do as well, with girls in the UK, I think, because we're a rich country, we can afford, a lot of people can afford sanitary protection. But we don't give girls choice at school. The education that they get is all about branded goods. So why don't they get choice of like moon cups? Moon cups? I don't know if anybody, especially the men who have seen a moon cup, maybe not some of the women. So these are moon cups made out of surgical silicone. They last 10 years. So really, really sustainable. Easy to use. So what we want to do is set up Tupperware parties, but coupleware parties. So we've actually been given quite a few of these from a company in Denmark, which is really good. So that's what we want to do. We wanted to have more research. There's not enough research on the research. Maybe 10-12% of girls and women in the UK can't afford sanitary protection. Why is that? The tampon tax, why is that there? Why is men's shavers and caviar not taxed? And a basic human right like a sanitary towel is taxed. It's not very good. So I suppose ideas for the future here, increase donation stations in supermarkets and workplaces. What I'd like to do, this lady here started free vending machines in Australia, so we're looking at doing free vends in community centres, in churches, where there's community kitchens and things like that. I want to get some volunteer training going, and of course education is a massive thing. Education, you need the girls and the boys to be educated together. So here has become the norm. Why is it that half the population of the world menstruate, but we still like a secret society? It's not talked about, it's a taboo subject, it's dirty, it's this. But actually, Women, if you didn't have appearance, you men would not be here. Okay? You wouldn't, would you? So that's what we want to do. We want to like educate everybody so we can talk about periods like we talk about the weather. Yeah? Okay? So yeah, I mean that's sort of what where we're at now. So into the future we want to sort of eradicate period poverty worldwide. And how different would this world be if all the girls had access to the education that they're entitled to? And just because they need some sanitary towels. And it doesn't take, you know, I'm just a normal person, mum of three, you know, grandmother, and, you know, I'm trying to do change, you know, affect change here, so can you.